Francis Galton was connected to University College London because he left his collection here. He left his archive of letters, of everything you could think of to do with Francis Galton, to this college. This is partly because towards the end of his life, he established something known as an anthropometric lab, which was essentially a lab for measuring people and detailing people's heredity. And it's this legacy that we're investigating in two exhibitions at the library and in the Petrie Museum, and a public programme which I've been working on. And Francis Galton is probably one of these massive polymath Victorian scientists, but today he's probably best known for his work on the area of eugenics, a word and term which he in fact coined from two Greek words, one for well, you, and one for blood or stock, sheen, or gen, or gen, where we get our word genetics from, or gene. He put these two words together to describe a movement that would encourage there to be better human stock, as he saw it, by the breeding of eugenically better or perfect people together. And therefore you would eradicate things like even alcoholism, TB, you would establish a kind of better health of certain people, you would establish a better intellectual level, those kind of ideas. But by the end of his life, by 1911, and certainly as a sort of build-up in the 1900s of interest and acceptance of eugenic ideas, there's a eugenics education society established, which are kind of a lobbying group. Most people of kind of upper middle class, upper class backgrounds accept, to some extent, sort of social and cultural eugenics. More positive eugenics, which is encouraging the breeding of, you know, eugenically perfect people, rather than negative, which is kind of discouraging or even stopping enforcing sort of people who are not deemed to be fit to have children. And it's in Britain, it's very much a sort of social and political movement rather than an area that actually made laws and stopped people doing things or encouraged people to do things. But of course, eugenics had an international impact even in Canada, America, South Africa, across the empire as it was in the British Empire then. But also in Europe, in Scandinavian countries, in mainland Europe, in Germany, for example. And it's this international legacy that obviously has come back to haunt eugenics, really since the Second World War, because of Nazism and because of the horrendous atrocities practiced by the Nazis through their eugenic programme against people with disabilities, against Jews, against people who were just considered feeble-minded or unfit to breed for whatever reason they determined. And also then, of course, massive sterilisation programmes in some areas of the United States and elsewhere. It's this kind of negative eugenics that's really haunted eugenics. And I think that's been a real problem, which is an understatement, but it's been a real problem in terms of analysing the impact of eugenics in Britain and the legacy of it today. Because we tend to establish ourselves as the good guys against the bad Nazi guys or against the bad racists in America who sterilised lots of black men. That, you know, in Britain we didn't really do very much around eugenics. We just had a kind of social movement, but it wasn't that wide-ranging. And in some ways that's kind of true, but in other ways it's meant that we've not really interrogated some of our social assumptions about some of the areas that Eugenic Society campaigned on. And just to pick out a few examples, areas such as who should have children, about how we screen people for having children, how our assumptions about parenting, for example, or watching things like the royal wedding recently and the marriage of Kate Middleton, a so-called commoner, to a member of the royal family, the next king after the next in line, if you like. And it was interesting hearing the commentary when she was marrying William about how she was bringing good, different stock and how her breeding was different to William's. And these were the kind of words that commentators were using. And in the newspapers, there was sort of Kate's family tree and investigation into her heredity in a way that's actually far more about class than anything to do with birth, and far more about sort of eugenic ideas about what constitutes breeding. And I was quite shocked by the use of some of these words like stock and breeding to sort of bring new blood into the royal family. And I think that shows that these ideas, these assumptions haven't gone away. And really what we should be doing, and what we should be doing, I think, in this centenary year of Francis Galton, is on the one hand celebrating all his great work, on the other hand commemorating the legacy for the people that his work also affected, but also interrogating ourselves on our history and also our own assumptions as academics and what that presents to non-academics in wider society about whether those, how many of that, those assumptions are still with us today, and how much we should be thinking about things differently around medicine, around representation, and around class.